Say bless, say bless, say
bless.
Yeah.
Grace and peace, everybody. Good morning. Thank you again for joining us on our live stream worship experience. I cannot tell you how overjoyed we are to have you share with us in the word of the Lord and in the presence of God. Listen, it's been a long time since we've been doing this live stream thing, but I want to tell you, even as a lot of us are getting comfortable kind of doing things online, I want you to sit up today. Make sure that you get into a space where you can really lock in to the Word of God today, lock into the presence of God. There's a lot of temptations out there. There's a lot of things that are going on. People are ready to get out of the house. We are going to the beach. We're traveling again. We're doing all of these things. But I want you to make sure that you understand that the fuel of your life is in the presence of God, that you're going to need God's presence. You need His Word, you need His presence, and you need God's people to make it through this world that we're living in today. So I'm glad that you're joining us online, but I want you to know something, that we got to be really intentional about making sure we lock in and receive what God is saying to us. We are in a crazy time and in a crazy hour, and if ever we needed to hear the Word of God, we need to hear it today. So listen, I'm going to pray, and once we pray, we're going to go back into our countdown. Then we're going to go into our worship experience this morning. God is still speaking to us from the message. We're still talking about the lesson, Christ over culture. Listen, I know that sounds tough for some of you right now. A lot of us are frustrated. A lot of us are angry. And bitterness wants to set in. Divisiveness is creeping through our land. But we want to make sure that as believers, we represent the kingdom of God first. Remember, Christ over culture. Let's pray. Father, we give you praise and glory. Thank you for this moment in time that you've given us to seek your face and to bask in the wonder of your name. God, I pray for everyone that would tune in to this live stream today, everyone that would stream with us. I pray your presence, oh God, be manifested wherever they are, in their home, in their car, as they're listening or as they're watching. I pray your presence, oh God, invade our lives. Father, thy kingdom come and thy will be done in this earth, Father. Cause your will, your authority, your government, and your plan to be revealed in our hearts and lives, and we'll give you praise and glory for it. Overshadow us with the glory of your great name, and we'll bless you and love you forever. In Jesus' beautiful name, amen and amen. All right, here we go. Going back to the countdown, then you're going to join us in our morning worship experience. God bless you. Thank you. Hey, let the river flow. For this hour, we are prepared for this hour. Help us to tap into the grace that you have given us to endure this hardship, and we give you praise. We give you glory in Christ's wonderful name. Amen and amen. Glory to God. In dealing with the issue of Christ over culture, I want to speak specifically to the issue of social unrest that we are facing as a nation. The first question that would come to mind, I spoke with several of my colleagues this week, and a lot of people are looking for escape from talking about or having hard conversations. A lot of people are looking, I had a pastor friend of mine, and I'm not judging them, I'm just giving you an example of what I'm saying. I had a pastor friend of mine says, you know what, when I want the Lord to give me a word that don't have nothing to do with COVID, don't have nothing to do with social issues, I just want to preach the gospel. I just want to preach the word of God. And even though that sounds really, really spiritual and really, really devout, my comments to him was, well, I need God to give me a guide and a compass on how to navigate through these times. So I need to invite God into our situation and ask him, what should we be doing in an hour like this? It would be good if we could teach about or preach about some other things. But the word of God is not given to us for escapism. Too many religious people, too many churchy people use the house of God for escapism. We'll praise God, but we nasty to each other. We'll shout and get an anointing, but we don't pray, we don't fast. We'll prophesy and look for the conference or the convention, but we don't live lives that are devoted to Jesus Christ. We'll want to hear a word, but we don't share the word with those that are around us. As a matter of fact, most of us spend most of our time talking the talk of the day as opposed to applying the wisdom of God for what the people of God should be doing at this hour. So I said all of that to say this. The reason why it's important that we deal with this and we look at this is because we need to understand that the world will never be healed until the house of God gets healed. The world will never be in a better place until the house of God gets into a better place. We are the champions and the leaders of all reconciliation, hope, and peace in the world. It's got to happen in the house of God first. Oh, God. And in order for us to get to that point, we've got several axes that we grind and several reasons why. One of the greatest reasons why we have a hard time with the idea of reconciliation and peace is because in most cases we have been victimized or mistreated or mishandled. And a lot of us, and I said it before and I'll say it again, there are a lot of us who are asking for justice, but then there are a lot of us that are asking for revenge. And you got to be careful that we don't allow ourselves to slip on that slippery slope. Justice is right to ask for. It's right to demand justice. It's right to say that this isn't fair. It's right to say that equality should exist among our nation and in our country. It is right to say we need to repent for the ways that we have set up things, either overtly or covertly, that makes injustice convenient. It's right to do that. But Jesus never gave us permission to exact revenge, because the Bible teaches vengeance is mine, saith the Lord, and he'll repay. It's not popular, I know, but it's the truth anyhow. So as we begin to talk about this, there are two main questions that I want to answer today, or at least try to answer today. The first question is, how did we get here? And I don't mean as a world, but I mean even in the church. How did we get here? The second question that we're going to answer today is, what should I be doing right now? What's the right course of action? Now, that second question is a little difficult, because the answer to the question, before you answer the question, has to be the direction of where you ought to be going and what you ought to be doing. It all depends on whether or not you have subjected your life to the word and will of God. If your life decisions are governed by things and people that are around us, your definition of what's the right thing to do might differ. But because I don't have the platform to speak to the world, I don't have the call or the assignment necessarily to correct what's going on in social society, our first mandate is to preach the gospel of Jesus Christ. So that's what we're going to do today, as we attempt to kind of iron this out. Last week, in talking about Christ over culture, we had to first look at this idea that we have developed. And I made a statement that I spent all week long answering. I spent all week long having discourse and discussion about this one statement that I made last week. So I figured, because it ruffled so many feathers, I might as well make the statement again. There are some people that are just glutton for punishment. When God, here was the statement that I made. Racism and culturalism, all racial bias, somebody say all of it. That's not on one side of the fence. We can't talk about racism in the white culture and not deal with the racism in the black culture. Can't talk, y'all quiet. You can't talk about racism in the white culture and not deal with the racism in the Hispanic culture or in the Chinese culture. Whatever culture it is, all racism is the idea of man. It is the creation of man. God never created it. He never intended for it. He never made it. He didn't come up with the concept or the idea. It is the concept of fallen man. We begin to prove that out last week by talking about the origins of the Garden of Eden. Because as Christian believers, there's a couple of things that we don't argue on. One of the things that we don't argue about is Eden is where life began. Eden is where God breathed the breath of life into man. The Bible says he formed man out of the dust of the ground. He breathed the breath of life into him, and man became a living nephesh, or a living soul. Eden is the place where all life began. Eden is the place, in fact, where science and theology still meet to this day. It is known as or called the cradle of civilization. We talked about where Eden was located geographically. We talked about it being found on the continent of Africa between the borders of eastern Sudan, Ethiopia, and Eritrea. We talked about that as a geographical fact, as we study the scriptures, as we're looking around Genesis 10, you can begin to see the formation. It's very important that you understand that, okay? It's very important that you understand that all civilization, all mankind started there on that continent. We got to understand it, and we have to accept it. Every time I talk about this, my stomach gets butterflies, and I get nervous because people think I'm going in a direction that I'm not going in, because I'm simply stating that simply because God started the thing there, he still never had a design in his mind for anybody to assume superiority over anybody. I hope you're hearing what I'm saying. All right. As a matter of fact, and this is where we got to really walk through the study. And I want you to get your Bibles again and go with me to Acts chapter 17. Acts chapter 17. As Paul is preaching, he goes into a town of, I believe it's Apollonia. If you read Acts chapter 17, verse 1, you'll see the town and the city that Paul went into. And they had erected an altar to something called an unknown god. This was a city that had not known the Lord. And Paul is preaching to them, and he's talking about this unknown God that they don't know anything about. So Paul is about to share with them in the book of Acts, give them some details about who this God is and the way he functions. Are you following me? All right. In Acts chapter 17, verse 24, I want you to get there, look at it. If you can't get there, look at it, write it down so you can read it later. But I'm going to read it now because it is important. Remember who Paul is talking to. Paul is talking to a people that had a statue of several different gods all around the city. They had a god of the moon, the god of the sun, the god of the water, the god of light, the god of dirt, the god of dust, the god of stars, the god of money, the god of poverty, the god. There were all of these gods. And when they had run out of altars to compare to things that they could not name, they named it the altar to the unknown god. You'll catch that later. You'll get it later. I know. When you run, never mind. Acts chapter 17, verse 24. Paul is now describing to them this God. Carefully, watch this. It says, God made the world and all things therein, seeing that he is the Lord of heaven and earth dwelleth not in temples made with hands. He is the Lord of heaven and earth. And he dwells not in temple made with hands. Y'all follow me. This is Paul telling them about the unknown God. He's saying, neither is worshiped with man's hands as though he needed anything. Seeing, they're talking about this God that they don't know. He gives life. He gives to all life and breath and all things. Talking about this God. He gives everybody life and breath and all things. This is very important in Acts 17, 26. If you're in the building, you need to get this. If you're on Facebook and it's in the chat, please get it there and get ready to highlight it. Because here is Paul, and I want you to hear this carefully. Not only is this applicable for these people in the book of Acts, but this is applicable for all of us today. As a matter of fact, you might miss a lot of other things that I'm going to say. Don't miss this. Write this on the tablet of your heart. In Acts chapter 17, verse 26, the Bible says, and hath made of one blood all nations of men for to dwell on the face of the earth, and hath determined the times before appointed and the bonds of their habitations, that they should seek the Lord, if haply they might feel after him and find him, though he be not far from every one of us. Verse 28 says, for in him we live, and in him we move, and in him we have our being. As certain also of your own poets have said. Now, I want you to understand verse 26 real clearly, because we're going to extract this one verse and we're going to cut and paste it, if you will, into the theme of what we're talking about. I made the statement earlier that God never had the concept of race in his mind. God never. You cannot, please hear me, you cannot be a believer in the Lord Jesus Christ and have a racist mind or a racist heart or racist ideologies or racist concept. You cannot consider, I know it's hard and I know it's tough, you can't consider yourself a follower of the way, a believer in Jesus Christ, a follower of the Lord Jesus Christ, a citizen of the kingdom of God without accepting Acts chapter 26. The Bible says that God made of one blood
all nations, God help me, of the earth. God made us of one blood. Y'all, I know it's tough and I know it's hard. And I'm speaking to some people, and believe me, my heart goes out to you. I can't condemn you for being angry. I can't condemn you for the hatred that the enemy is trying to rise up in your heart. All I can tell you to do is fight it by the blood of Jesus. All I can tell you to do is don't give in to it. For by one blood, God says at the end of the day, your skin tone might be different, but your blood is the same. The cradle of all civilization. Now, next week, we're going to really deal with this verse. I can't deal with it now because I don't have time. But next week, we're going to really deal with this because things we are experiencing and have been fighting for over 400 and some odd years, the Bible has already answered. Somebody, somewhere throughout time and throughout history started declaring, teaching, preaching, and promoting an idea that was not biblical and that was not based on the supremacy of Christ in truth. All right? God says, all mankind he made as one blood. That's blessing my whole sanctified heart right now. That's blessing my whole sanctified heart right now because I need y'all to understand that racism, classism, and all forms of division never came from God. I want to say it as I look deeply and closely into the camera. I don't know if you can zoom in and get my mug real tight, but I'm getting ready to get an attitude and I was trying to be composed. I'm getting ready to get upset because there are too many of us in the Holy Ghost that are more loyal to our culture than we are to this cross. There are too many of us that cannot worship together because our styles differ. We cannot worship together because you sing hymns and I like Hillsong. You like Hillsongs, I like gospel. We can't worship together simply because we have a preference and we have anointed our preference above the will and word of God. And so I have to declare it. If nobody else will say it, I have to declare it. If nobody else will declare it, all of it is a man-made idea. None of it has come from God. And there is not a style. There is not a chord. There is not a key. There is not a scale that God prefers above another. Now, you might prefer it above another, but please know that God loves it all. Give me a little more if I can. If I can get some without causing a mess. If I can't, hallelujah. So God never intended. He never considered race. I want to say it again. God never considered race. Never. Listen to me when I say. And here's why I must say it this way. Because there are too many of us that are trying to use the scriptures to co-sign our racial bias. There are too many of us that are trying to quote the scriptures to justify our desire for supremacy. And as I speak this, I'm not talking about one side of the aisle. But there are too many of us that are preaching a gospel out of context because we are preaching it with the mind of racism and classism. We are preaching it with a Western American mind and we're not preaching proper biblical text. Bishop, how did we get here? Racism has a seemingly long and deep-reaching roots in our world. It seems to have always been with us. And can I say you that it always has? Didn't have the name racism. In the Bible, they call it sin. They call it pride, what have you. The concept that we experience in this country of racism, even though it has long and deep roots, is relatively new as it pertains to the rest of the world. Racism was actually introduced to modern society after the Renaissance period. In other words, 1300 to 1600. That's when actually racism began to introduce. In ancient times, men were not referred to by race or by color. They were referred to by tribes. In other words, you gained your, if there was a term, social identity, or you gained your ethnicity, not by color, but by tribe. And you can read it all throughout the Bible. The Bible talks about the Greeks and the Persians and the Jews and the Sextans and the Ethiopians and the Egyptians. Why is it important that you understand the Bible never talked about people by color? Y'all ain't gonna like what I'm getting ready to say. The Bible never dealt with people by color. It dealt with them by tribes. Why? Because color had no bearing on what tribe you were from. If the birthplace of all mankind is Genesis and God created all men from there, you got to look at Abraham and Noah. Abraham and Noah began the, they are progenitors, if you will, of humankind outside of Adam. So it does not matter, you were not represented by the color of your skin, you were represented by the tribe or the region that you inhabited. Y'all ain't gonna like what I'm getting ready to say. So if you were born Ethiopian, but you moved to Rome, and your skin got lighter because there wasn't a lot of sun there, you were not allowed to classify yourself as anything other than Ethiopian, even though your skin complexion was lighter. All right, that's too much. How we get here, Bishop? There was a man, a German, they called him a naturalist, and y'all forgive my pronunciation, Johann Friedrich. That's what his name is. Blamach, okay? Blumanbach. All right, there you go. He is credited, according to historians, he is credited as one of the founding fathers of the idea that people were divided by skin color. He is credited as a man who started the idea of dividing people not by tribe or region, but by skin color. He also partnered with another man who we'll talk about later to create the science that they believe justified slavery. Now, Johann didn't create racism, nor did he create slavery as a practice. But he was just the individual or one of the individuals that is given credit for the starting of identifying people by race or color or complexion. So his studies gave to us five complexions or colors. The Malaysian color or the yellow color, the yellow man. The Ethiopian color or the black man. The American color, the red man. The American color was the red man. Some of us got to stop claiming stuff that ain't ours. The Mongolian color, which is the brown man. And then there was the Caucasian or the white race. Sons, y'all ain't gonna like this, of Abraham who migrated above the Caucasus Mountains. Left there and started families and generations. Skin becomes lighter. We get the term Caucasian from the Caucasus Mountains. Now, again, this was not the will and word of God. God did not identify men by color. Man decided to do it. I will not spin the whole narrative because the narrative is not only divisive, but it is contrary to where we're trying to go. And that's putting the cross over culture. I am simply saying to you that if my cultural difference or the color of my skin is enough to divide us and make us angry, we cannot occupy in that spirit and the Holy Spirit at the same time. Joseph Arthur de Gobineau. Joseph Arthur de Gobineau, a 19th century French aristocrat. His studies during the same time legitimized the science of racism. He developed the concept. There is a book, and I would not name the book because I don't want you to get it, but I gave you his name, so if you want to Google him, they're going to tell you anyway. But he developed a book. It's about a 2,000-page thesis that talks about one race being superior to them all due to the shape of their skull or where they lived. It is his idea, after this Renaissance period, during the time of the year was about from 1300 to 1600, 1300 to 1700, these ideals, please hear me carefully, was considered at that time breakthrough modern science. Do you follow me? These ideas were considered at this time breakthrough modern sciences. In other words, these men were considered brilliant thinkers of their time. They were respected as brilliant researchers of their time. So whenever their ideals were published, the mass of the society, please hear me carefully, the masses of the society believed it. Oh, you don't believe me? They believed it so much so. Here is how you know they believed in this theory. On yesterday, we just finished celebrating the birthday of the United States. We celebrated the birthday, the signing of the Declaration of Independence, and we shot fireworks and had barbecues and all of that stuff. I'm not going to vilify that because, again, it is contrary to what I believe God is saying to us at this hour. But we celebrated the 4th of July and the signing of the Declaration of Independence that was written by our forefathers. Our forefathers penned at the beginning of this Declaration of Independence. One of the things that they stated inside of that declaration was this, that we hold these truths to be self-evident, that all men are created equal. Y'all ever heard that before? They penned it when they wrote the Declaration of Independence, while at the same time penning it, they were owning people as property. I know you want to demonize them, but the problem was they thought they were operating in the social science of the day. Yeah, there was prayer that happened at the signing of the Declaration of Independence. Can I help you? There was massive prayer. There are letters that state, letters that are written by this country's forefathers that talked about prayer that took place as they were signing it, one nation under God. The problem then is similar to the problem now. They had picked what things they were going to call sin. They had picked what things that they decide was ungodly. And in their mind, their superiority was not ungodly, but it was their God-given right. And that's where we begin to mix Americana with Christianity as if they are the same. I know I'm going to get in trouble. I realize it. But let me stand firm on what I'm saying again. I am saying that all humankind are fallen beings, and we are in need of a righteous Savior. I am saying that there is not one of us that can assume superiority over nobody. I can gain some pride out of the scripture because I can see somebody who looks like me in it. But I cannot assume that I am superior over another culture. And I cannot allow hatred and anger and divisiveness and the wickedness of Americana to take my soul, which Jesus redeemed, and dip it back in the blackness of hate. And I'm sorry. Because Lord knows I love my people, but I understand, and I do it too. Every time we cut on television, every time we go on social media, there is something there that the media pushes to further divide us and make us angry. Now it seems like it is the thing to do to show a police cam with somebody being brutally murdered or mishandled. It seems like it's the thing. I'm not saying, God help me, Holy Ghost, that these things didn't need to be exposed, because I got news for America. For those of us that want to declare it's a media ploy, no, beloved, it is the eyes of the Lord that are in every place that are beholding the evil and the good of men. And I am sorry that, but your sins are finding you out. And you may know of only 9. I heard somebody say the other day, it's only 9 that have been killed in the last year, while Planned Parenthood has killed thousands. And I must agree that Planned Parenthood has killed thousands. But something is wrong with your number 9. It's only 9 that you know about. It's only 9 that you've seen. God help me stay on track. I am simply trying to make the point to you this. That somehow between the Renaissance period and the foundations of our country, man's idea of science and culture got mixed into the word and will of God. Do you follow me? God help me, Holy Ghost. Y'all looking at me real weird. But can I really be honest? I gotta call this thing like I see it. We cannot demonize white culture because they allowed secular ideas of the time to influence their theology. We can't demonize them because we do the exact same things. We try to mix humanism with the word of God. We try to mix existentialism with the word and will of God. We try to live our truth over and above God's truth. We try to do our thing our way and mixing our opinions with the word of God. And whenever man's opinions try to congeal itself with the word of God, you always end up with the false dichotomy. It's dangerous. Hear me. You want to be sanctified and you want to cast judgment on another culture? You want to cast judgment on another race? What about the things you are mixing with the truth of God's word? What about the times where we mix this secular society with the truth of God's word? What about the times where we want to mix? If you'll notice, y'all ain't going to like what I'm getting ready to say, but it is our culture that has a celebration of gospel, which is really only a celebration of R&B artists singing a gospel song with gospel people, and we rejoice as if it's holy, when the Bible declares, come out from among them and be ye separate. So quiet. We justify things that are not biblical because they're cultural. Y'all don't like what I'm saying, but I got to say it again because I love you. We justify things. I'm not saying it's easy. The devil is a liar. I'm not saying that it's not hard. The devil is a liar. I'm not saying that we are not challenged to do right every day. And I'm not saying that we hit the mark all the time. Can I be really transparent? Everything that God says, I don't like it, but I gotta do what I gotta do if I'm gonna stay with him. Everything that God says, I might want to disagree, but I gotta do what he says do if I want to be with him. So here's the problem. That's how we got here. Some people says, well, we don't have slavery anymore. We've outlawed it. No, you've outlawed overt slavery. You've outlawed overt racism. What's happening now is gastric reflux. What's happening now is God, help me, Holy Ghost, is trying to get his church to acknowledge that it's some things that in order for you to get forgiveness from, you got to repent. And you cannot repent where there is no acknowledgement. David said, my sins are ever before me. He said, against thee and thee only have I sinned. In other words, if you ever want to get delivered, I can't tell you what I read in the book. I can only tell you what I had to walk through myself. If you ever really want to get free, God is not going to free you by getting back at your enemies. God is only going to free you when you develop a subjective prejudice and say, I got a problem and I need you to help me. Purge me with hyssop that I shall be clean. Wash me and I'll be whiter than snow. It's got to be a personal thing. You ain't got time to worry about your enemies. Look at your neighbor, tell him you got to get yourself together. Bishop, it's dark, I can't see, but you hear voices, you know somebody in here. The reality of it is we are so busy trying to police everybody else's spirituality till we miss our opportunity to grow. I do not stand before you as a perfect man. I do not stand before you as a man without flaw. I do not stand before you as a man without struggle. But I stand before you as a man that is committed to this cross. As a man that is committed to this message. And even if I got to break my own self down. And until America gets to that point, we won't experience revival. That's how we got here. We got here because there was a time where people mixed the idea of the day and culture with the word of God. Christianity was not introduced by black people in 1619. They have told, and I'm so tired, the next YouTube dummy that posted, I'm gonna scream. We've not simply studied the word of God. The oldest church in the world is in Ethiopia. In the world. It's not possible that you have a gospel that started on the continent and tell me we got introduced to it in 1619. What we got introduced to was an Americana version. And that is the problem with our state right now. Because we're preaching Americana and we ain't preaching the whole counsel of God. Let me get out of this. Bishop, what do we do? I know why we got here. I understand it. Do you really understand it? I hope you understand it enough that it helps you deal with your hate. Oh God, I wish I was in a regular church. I would tell you to high five three people and tell them you got to get over the hate. You got to let it go.
You got to, oh, no, you got, you might have to grab your brother's hand or grab an air hug and hug him tight. Let me hold you tight. And I know you're mad and you're crying and you're frustrated and you're pounding your fist. I'm there with you, but you got to let it go. I need you to understand that even though it hurts and it breaks your heart and you're frustrated and you're tired of asking for something that God ordained you to have. You're tired of asking for something that you shouldn't have to ask for. But I am telling you, it is a plan of the enemy. If you start hating and you start responding with bitterness and you start responding with revenge, it is the plan of the devil to make you into the very evil you're marching against. This is not an extra biblical event. Matt, where you at? I might need your help. I ain't going to be able to make it through this. Y'all going to have to get it on YouTube. Sorry. What I'm saying is, help me walk through this, Holy Ghost. It's not an extra biblical event. This thing is nothing new. The scriptures have always had to contend with the idea and concepts of racism and superiority. The Bible is full of them. The New Testament is full of arguments. I showed you one last week. I read to you another one this week. Jesus in the text is cornered by a lawyer. Please understand that when the scripture talks about lawyers in the context of the New Testament, he's talking about people that are astute in the law of Moses. The law that governed those people in that day was what we read in our Old Testament, considering the word of God. Do you follow me? So this was not about law as it pertains to just the state or law as we perceive it. But this lawyer was a lawyer. In other words, he was astute in the laws of God. He understood as a Hebrew that he was a part of God's chosen people. Y'all follow me? He understood as a Hebrew that he was a part of God's chosen people. So he corners Jesus and he asks Jesus a question. This is what I love about this, and this is what some of you need to learn. There are some questions that people ask of you not to be enlightened, but they ask questions for the purpose of debate. Can I really help you? The truth of the matter is, I got convicted the other day for getting into a debate on social media. And when I got off the debate, the Holy Ghost simply asked me, he said, Red, you good now? And I said, God, what you mean? He said, because everything you just said is disqualified because it's out of my will. Because the Bible says in Romans that the children of the Lord ought not strive. In other words, you ain't got no business fighting with nobody. Let every man be persuaded in his own mind. If you want to be a dummy, I'm going to let you be a dummy. If you want to be ignorant, I'm going to let you be ignorant. If you want truth, then we can have a conversation. It's not popular, but it's true. The lawyer confronts Jesus. Let me hurry and get to the point. When he confronts Jesus, he says, tell me what I must do to gain eternal life. How can I live right? Tell me, how can I live holy? I love what Jesus says. Jesus doth, watch this, y'all ain't paying attention to your Messiah. Jesus didn't get offended or angry. He didn't perceive that the lawyer was coming to trap him up, even though he knew that's what it was. Y'all ain't, you ain't catch that. You ever had somebody ask you a question and you know they don't really mean the sincerity of the question, they're just trying to trip you up in the words? See, you and me would have got mad. What you asking me that for? But Jesus simply asked him a question. He says, have you read the law? He says, yeah, I read the law. He says, well, what does the law say? I love this, because remember what the man asked him, what do I have to do to attain eternal life? The law said, love, God have mercy, the Lord your God, and love him with all your heart, love him with all your might, love him with all your soul, y'all ain't got it, love him with all your strength to inherit eternal life. Can I tell you the truth of what Jesus said? If you perfect the love issue, I'll perfect your morality issue. God help me, Holy Ghost. He says, if you love me with all of your heart, that means your every heartbeat thinks about me. If you love me with all of your strength, that means all of your effort is put forth in pleasing me. If you love me with all of your might, that means every dime you make, every job you take, every place you go to, you do it as unto the glory of the living God. And then he said, love your neighbor as yourself. Here's the trouble. Because the lawyer, who was a Hebrew, knew that he was God's chosen. So the Bible says specifically, the Bible says, Brother Gary, specifically, he did not ask out of curiosity. The Bible says, willing to justify himself. He said, who is my neighbor? In other words, Jesus, are you going to give me the law, which says that the Hebrew people are God's chosen people? Because I'm not supposed to cast that which is holy to the dogs. The lawyer had a race problem.
Jesus says, the law says, love your neighbor as yourself. He got smart with Jesus. Well, who my neighbor be? Who that? Who that, Lord? Jesus tells him a story. I wish y'all were here with us last week. Because the same nationality that Jesus dealt with last week in John 4, he ironically chooses the same nationality. Now here in Luke, he doesn't deal with the why, but John 4 teaches us the why. Because the woman at the well, who's a Samaritan, says to Jesus, you are a Jew, and the Jews have no dealings with the Samaritan. We don't deal with them. We don't hang out with them. We don't talk to them. God help me, Holy Ghost. So I want you to watch this, and I'm going to make just three quick observations because I don't have time to dig out the whole text. But Jesus gives them a story. He says, there was a man walking on the Jericho road who was robbed and mugged by thieves. They beat him, stripped his clothes off of him, and left him there for dead. Why did they strip the clothes off of him, Bishop? So that when they beat him and they ran away, he could not get up to chase them because of his scars and his nakedness. A lot of times when the enemy molests you, his job is not only to wound you, but to embarrass you. Anybody who uses embarrassment tactics can't be flowing in the Spirit of God. And those of us who consume other people's embarrassment cannot be considered saved. I'm sorry to tell you that. If you need tea in the house of God, Lord, help me, Holy Ghost. You really can't consider yourself full of God's Holy Ghost because you need tea. I know it. While I got you mad and quiet, let me say most of us are more concerned about tea than we are about the Scripture. You know more about people's business than you do the Word of God. You can tell everybody's story about where they've been, who they've been with, and why they've been there, but you can't effectively lead a person to Calvary. Let me get out of that because that's not what I'm talking about. Jesus says this man is beaten, he's naked, he's left within an inch of his life. You know how the story goes, so I really don't have to tell you. I just want to extract a point that we got to get today before we leave this building. He says there was a priest and a Levite. Remember, he's talking to a lawyer, a person who was a student of the law, so he knows what a priest and a Levite did. So my question was not necessarily just a judgment against the priest and the Levite, but now I'm curious as to why. I know what they did. One looked at him and kept walking. The other didn't even look at him. He just kept walking. They ignored the man that was on the side having a need. So before I even get into how wrong and how dastardly that was concerning their culture, but I just want to pull out, just extract these three questions or these three observations that the Holy Ghost and I begin to make. Because my question is, God, why did they leave that man laying there? So when I began to research it, I read one writer, as he said, that the priest was on the Jericho road because there was catechisms that were provided in the city of Jericho. In other words, there were students there that had to be taught. So the priest had to hurry up and get to his little Sunday school class. So he didn't have time because he was busy, God help me, performing his religious ritual. And that's why a lot of us can't get delivered, and that's why a lot of us can't get this cross over our culture. Because we are so busy dealing with our religious ritual till we won't address the wickedness of our own heart. We won't address the fact that we have hearts that lack the next thing. I said, God, that explains the priest, but why in the world would the Levite go? And you know, I got a little confused because we were always taught that priests and Levites were one and the same. But as I began to study it even further, I found out that Levites were more adjutants than priests. Levites was most of the time the ones that made sure everything was good. So you got the bishop and the administrator. The bishop looked and kept walking because he got to teach a class. And the administrator walking because he got to carry the bishop's briefcase and don't have time to see to those that are hurting. I'm closing as I get to this point. First problem, they were too busy. That's a problem with American culture. You know what's happening to us right now? We can't draw closer to God and milk the benefits of this time because we are too busy.
Can I help you? Some of you are busy being busy. Can I really be honest? You are miserable because you're in a time that won't let you be busy. Can I ask you a question? What are you missing now that you weren't missing this time last year? Only the ability to be busy. God help me, Holy Ghost. We are frustrated, not because someone told us we got to stay in the house. We are frustrated because we would rather be busy than be effective. We would rather be busy than be intentional. We would rather be busy. That's why a lot of us go to church just to perform. We don't care about the power. All we care about is the performance. So it doesn't matter to us how much preparation, time, and prayer goes into laboring or before the presence of God that people might be blessed. We are only concerned about being busy. Number one, they were too busy. Number two, they lacked the very essence of Jesus Christ. Brother Gary, they lacked compassion. Mm-hmm. The very thing that caused Jesus to come from heaven was his compassion for mankind. Y'all are hearing me today? They lacked compassion. They looked on him, and perhaps, hear me, America, instead of having compassion on the wounded man, possibly they were judging Elder Ted why he was in the position he was in. Probably thinking if he had not been in sin, he wouldn't have got beat up like that. Probably thinking that if he hadn't been the type of person that he was, then he wouldn't have been caught up like that. Isn't it amazing how the same God that delivers and pardons us has got to judge everybody else? Isn't that funny? Finally, and this was the biggest point that broke my heart the most. I said, God, why did they leave him? Number one, they were too busy. Number two, they lack compassion. Why can't we solve the race problem in America? Because we're too busy trying to get it. Trying to get money. Trying to get famous. Trying to make history without repenting of a history and make a better future. And we lack simple compassion. As a nation, we lack simple compassion. Something, you can say what you want, in the inner fibers of this country, lack simple compassion. But the third thing that they lacked is an indictment in the church. We can say the world is too busy to care. We can say the world lacks compassion. But the third thing they lack, Gary, is a gavel of indictment against the house of God. Even if they had stopped Mimi, even if they had stopped to help him, Matt, they had no oil and they had no wine. They represented today's church. We got a 400-year-old problem that we can't heal. Because we have sacrificed our oil and we despise our wine. Bishop, what are you saying? The wine represents the word of God. It is an antiseptic. It is a disinfectant. He poured in wines in his wounds to clean out the dust. Y'all hear me? He poured the wine in his wounds to clean out what would have been infection. He poured the wine in his wounds, and the wine in the wounds of America has got to be God's truth. But there's not enough of us that are acquainted with the wine to be able to pour it. Y'all ain't hearing what I'm saying. Please look at your neighbor and tell him you got to stock up on some wine. No. I know you got wine in the back of your refrigerator. But I'm talking about a wine that'll get you drunk so much so till even when you see bad news on the internet, it don't affect you because you're affected by the wine. God help me, Holy Ghost. America, please hear me. American church, please hear me. We are serving people Kool-Aid. In other words, we are tickling their fancy. We are serving people milkshakes. In other words, we are giving them something to draw them. We are treating grown people like children. If you ever want to get a child to eat all of their vegetables, you tell them you can't have no more to drink until you eat these vegetables. And the child's desire for something sweet may cause them to eat the vegetables. And the church for years have been serving up something sweet to the world when they need the burn of the wine of truth resonating in their spirit. You need the burn of the wine of truth resonating in your womb. Let me finish this. They had no wine. And so I'm asking the church. Forget it, I can't talk to the church. But I'm asking the river, where is our wine? Are we sipping on the soda of the culture? Or do we take every day and sip from the grapevine of God's holy truth and say, make me drunk and take me out of this present culture? I don't know about you, but the Church of Jesus Christ needs to get drunk again. They said that they were drunk on the day of Pentecost, not just because they spoke in tongues, not just because of the sound of the wind, but they were drunk because they didn't act like everybody else acted. They didn't behave like everybody else behaved. We live in a world where we want to be sober when it comes to the presence of God, but we want to be drunk when it comes to the turn up. Please look at your neighbor and tell him you got to change your appetite. Lord, I need the wine. I'm closing. They didn't have any wine, but tragically, Mello, they ain't have no oil. So they had to walk by him. F, Matt. They had to walk by him. Just so they wouldn't be exposed for not having. You know what happened a few months ago? God sent an inspector called COVID-19 into the American church, and he shut down our conventions. He shut down our concerts. He shut down our traveling just to see who had the oil. Because if you got oil, it doesn't matter what container you put me in. Oil will assume the shape of whatever container it's poured into. So take away my cry, but you can't take my oil. Take away my approval, but you can't take my oil. Take away my position, but you can't take my oil. And can I tell you the truth, Church of God? What the devil's really trying to do with all of this hatred, with all of this division, with all of this bitterness, is he is after your oil. Because oil and anger don't work. Oil and anger cannot mix. That's why you gotta put cross over the culture. That's why you can't search for revenge. Because if I get too angry, you're going to mess up my oil. And if you mess up my oil, I can't help heal the nation. I can't help heal the world. Why in the world is it taking us 400 years as children of God to deal with this demon? It's because we've lost the wine and lost the oil. I'm finishing this. Listen. Oil and wine was used by the Samaritan for two reasons. Y'all, I hope y'all ready to catch this and we go home, I promise. You're on Facebook, you better catch this. Watch this. Wine was used as a antiseptic, Neosporin. Get out the infection.
One writer said, I wish I could pronounce his name, but it was one of the early church fathers. He said that the Samaritan carried wine to take care of his wounds, and he carried oil to mollify the sting of the wine. You ever had a cut and somebody poured alcohol in it? It stings, because sometimes the truth of God's word Mickey, I'm persuaded that our problem is we don't like stinging words. We don't like words that sting us. Now, look, if we go and research the problem with the postmodern church and the old church, somewhere in some sort of psychology, they told us to not be combative when we teach and preach. By not being combative, they said, in other words, take the sting out of what you say. It was the sting that kept our parents clean. But y'all ready for this? Because this is what messed me up. When the writer says he carried wine as an antiseptic and the oil to mollify, I said, oh my God, I never heard that word. What's mollify? I didn't know what it means. And you might can look it up, M-O-L-L-I-F-Y. What's mollify? Now, the Webster's Dictionary says mollify. Well, let's deal with it in the Greek text first. In the Greek text, mollify is to soothe. It's to soothe. Watch this. And the reason why they put oil on the skin, once you've cleaned it out, is it makes the skin elastic so it can heal better. Dry skin breaks. In our community, we call it ash. But moisturized skin has elasticity to it. So watch, you pour in the wine and it stings them, but you pour in the oil and it gives them the ability to heal over time. Any church you go to that you ain't never been stung, you in the wrong place. I'm so sorry, but every place that's going to be holistic has got to confront dysfunction. But the word mollify in the English took it even further. The word mollify means to appease anger and anxiety. You missed it. The oil is necessary to pour over the anger and the fierce anxiety. So to answer the question, what should the church be doing right now? Pouring in the oil and pouring in the wine. Oh God, whose side should we be on? We should be on the side that has the oil and the wine. Stand to your feet with me, I'm finished. A lot of us have sacrificed our oil and our wine for the culture. Hear me when I say this to you. I hope you hear me today. Last week, and I hope my friends are watching this week, because I told them I was going to snitch. I told them I was going to tell everybody what they said about me. They say, Reb, you sound like you're selling out. You telling us not to be angry. And they said, that's been the problem with the church for years. They've been telling us forgive and not be angry, and now's the time to be angry. So I told them, I said, man, listen. I said, I'd be a hypocrite if I told you not to be angry, because I'm angry. I said, I'd be a hypocrite if I told you not to be frustrated, because I'm frustrated. But I cannot allow the emotions of my culture to move me beyond the convictions of the cross. Y'all ain't hearing this. Some of you don't understand what the enemy is attacking. BG, some people in church think the enemy is after their name. Some people think that the enemy's after their reputation. Some people think that the enemy, Brother Gary, is after their family. But you know what he's after more than anything? Your oil. If he can get you bitter, if he can get you broken. It ain't you that's protecting your family. It's your oil. It ain't you that's protecting your name. It's your oil. Many of you, the enemy is trying to get you angry, fearful, and frustrated. So you'll give up your oil for revenge. There are churches all over this country that have lost the power and presence of God because they have exchanged the oil for their culture. We've exchanged oil for the approval of the world. The oil costs. And I ain't talking about money. The oil costs your friends. The oil costs you nights at the house chilling by yourself while everybody else is out turned up. Oh, y'all looking at me real funny. But there are many of us in this room and watching on this stream that your oil has been up for negotiation far too long. The only thing that could have helped the mugged man was the oil. And God had to give it, not through a priest, not through a Levite, but to an outcast, racially discriminated against Samaritan. Here's what we're going to pray. And this is my simple prayer. Today I'm not going to pray for you, but I'm going to pray with you. I love that. Thank you. Love that. I'll cling to the old rugged cross. Yeah. Cling to the old rugged cross, and I'll exchange it someday for a crown. Not going to pray for you. I'm going to pray with you today. Because we're going to pray that in the midst of chaos, confusion, division, if I got to speak truth to power, let me speak it to power and not be bitter. If I got to protest, let me protest, but let me do it peacefully. If I got to go to work, let me not go to work and give the evil eye to people that are around me. Because I sat home all week and feasted on vile violence and disgusting inhumane treatment. Because I got to put the cross over my culture. Listen to me. I'm so grateful for this moment. Some of you who are watching me, I'm going to give you a challenge and just tell you the truth. You are only as effective as the oil and wine that you have. A priest with no oil is a politician. A Levite with no wine is a performer. Tara, I'll stay frustrated with myself to keep the oil. I sit in my room and cry. I bang my fist on the floor because I'm angry or I'm hurting. But I know that this anger gonna pass. What's gonna really keep me is the oil. At the end of the day, the only thing that's going to preserve your life is the oil of God. You got to fight to
your oil. Your friends want to wild out and rah-rah. Sometimes you might be bored to death. But keep your oil. Might not be able to go where they go and do what they do, but keep your oil. Father, in Jesus' name, as a nation, if we're honest, we are the priests and we are the Levites. We have allowed our culture and the problems of this world to compromise our oil and wine. Lord, we can't afford to cast judgment on the whole of the planet. We can't talk about everybody else. But on this live stream and in this church, all we can say, all we can do is humbly beg you, don't let us lose our oil. Lord, some of us, we've been serving through this pandemic and we've been serving. But to be honest, our oil is being compromised. Some have been home on live stream, satisfied, comfortable, without recognizing that their wine is running low. My prayers for our city, no, Lord, for our church, our community, our city, our nation, and our world. Give us again the oil of God. Give us again the oil of God. Help us, Lord, that we don't end up like a powerless priest and a Levite with a low level. But help us to be the Samaritan. Racially discriminated against, having to deal with the scars of racism, social injustice, Jim Crow, 13th Amendment, redlining, civil rights movement. All of it doesn't give us permission to walk in hatred and bitterness. But give us, as a church, red, yellow, black, white, give us as a church the oil and the wine. Cancel all divisions between us. Help us to love our brothers of the same blood. We give you praise. We give you glory. We bless your name. Just right here, just for a second. Matt, just keep playing that. I just want to just, we don't even have to sing it. We don't even have to sing it. But just take a moment. Just take a moment right now. The words to the song says, I'll cling to the old rugged cross. Because sometimes we need to go back to the place of our devotion and need to allow the Lord to reestablish our dedication. We ain't doing this for people. We ain't doing this for fame. We ain't doing this for numbers. We ain't doing this for money. We're doing this for the glory of the cross. We're doing it for the glory of the cross. It's the cross that's redeemed us. It's the cross that set us free. Come on, you need to open your own mouth and tell the Lord, Lord, I need you to make sure. I need the oil back over my life. I need you to fill up my vat with wine. If you got to change my skin, change it. But give me the wine. In the name of Jesus, don't let me be stiff. Don't let me be hard-hearted. In the name of the Lord Jesus. Father, we give you praise and glory. Thank you now for the glory of your presence. 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 In this moment, let healing flow. Lord, there's some relationships that need the oil and the wine poured over them. There's some job situations that need oil and wine poured over them. There's some marriages that need oil and wine poured over them. Father, there's some people in their hearts and their minds, they are tormented. There are some who have been abused and neglected. There are some cases all over this country that may not have made the mainstream media, but God, pour in the oil and the wine. We need the oil and the wine poured in our nation. We need the oil and the wine poured in our president. We need the oil and the wine poured in our Senate. We need the order and the wine poured in on our government. We need the oil and the wine poured in on our churches. We need the oil and the wine poured on our pastors. We need the oil and the wine poured in on our worship leaders. We need the oil and the wine poured in on our leaders in the church. We need the oil and the wine poured on us, oh God. Hallelujah. I'm going to lay my concern at this altar. When I walk from this desk, I won't carry the concern. The enemy want me to be concerned because some of you I'm worried about. Some of you I'm worried about. Your oil's at stake. Your oil's at stake. You don't have to walk in peace just to feel good. Bump feeling good. Sometimes you got to walk in a place of peace to preserve the oil. The enemy will torment your mind to get at your oil. He will torment your heart to get at your oil. Blessed be the name of the Lord Jesus. Will you clap your hands and give God great praise as we're going to get ready to pray out of here today. I want you to consider that. I got to put the cross over my culture. Hallelujah. Got to keep my wine. Glory to God. Bless you.
Come on and put your hands together and tell God thank you for the word. Put your hands together and tell God thank you for the word. Father, we thank you for your word. Were you all blessed this morning by the word? Were you all blessed to receive it this morning? But we want to say thank you for joining us this morning. We want to say thank you for taking the time to come and worship the Lord with us and to receive his word. Because when he sends his word, he is sending it to heal us, to set us free, to make